possa volno pravo sumu, vidimo se musim u sebi i cena gospoda našeho sja. Fodra hal nesa hala.
I da imeni krajeva i upravi svilko prijeti koji molenje, hoću mi kate vas na svijetom roju i na našu sredsku zemlju. Хочу подякувати вас за вашу участь на Україні вже четвертий місяць підряд, де війна спровокована нашим відвічним сусідом. Протягом цього часу українська земля вкрилася тисячами групів новітних героїв, половиною громадянства, включно із рідним дітьми та молоді. Тому є дуже важливо, що наша українська і союзська громада зібралося разом для шанування пам'яті не тільки наших історичних героїв, але і тих, які щодня на наших очах стають героями. Хочу подякувати всі державницькі організації, які брали участь у співпраці до проведення нинішнього свята. Хочу також подякувати праву із Кселі за їхню працю, сильну працю на підготовку цього свята. Тепер до проведення нашої сумської цьогочної програми передаю мікрофон назад голови головної вправи Очосу Друга Микола Господарова.
Дякую. Дякую, пане Марасю. Нині 130-й день геноцидної війни в Україні. Ми тут зібралися нині вітати шану героя, нашим українським героям. Також ми маємо це буде свято американської незалежності завтра, 4 липня. Так як ми знаємо з нашої історії, для українського народу Сполучені Штати все було приклад незалежності і волі. Ми знаємо з нашої історії, з нашої літератури, що саме Тарасу Шевченку все закликав, коли ми будемо мати нашого Вашингтона. Тобто Джордж Вашингтон, який саме боровся за американську незалежність. І це було приклад для українського народу. Так як ми знаємо, 8 років тому відбувся Майдан, були смерті Небесної Сотні, і розпочалася українська-російська війна на Сході України. Ми знаємо в той час, так як за часів американської революції були американські Minutemen, це були добровольці, які повстали і розпочали американське військо. В той час були добровільні батальйони, які розпочалися і почали захищати Україну на Донбасі. 8 років пізніше повномасштабне вторгнення на цілу територію України. І це не є для нас диво. До вашої інформації, кілька років тому назад ми, наші батьки, тобто наші батьки у пісті, вони виробили план, щоб перетворити товариство, щоб передати нащадкам. І саме пані Зені, пружини, її батько, багато з вас його знали, як Бурий, це його псевдоз УПА, окей, є головою нашого товариства. І через те, що ми відзначуємо 80-ліття УПА цього року, саме припало честь подрузі Зені, щоб висловити святочне слово від наших організацій. Після святочного слова ми будемо мати привіт від України. Зараз ми лагодимо технічні справи тут. Я вибачаю за це. Але я прошу подругу Зеню до слова.
Я маю досить голосний голос. Я думаю, що без мікрофону. Чи ви мене ще чуєте?
Так.
І нема відгуку. Добре. Шановна святочна громада, історія повторяється. після Другої світової війни російська пропаганда переконувала світ, цілий світ, що вона має особливі інтереси щодо України. Вона просто хотіла створити буферну державу на своєму кордоні. І Україна від цього виграє. Ну, бо все ж таки вони брати. Все це звучало розумно для нового світового порядку. І з 1940-х років Росію вважали однією з трьох великих держав світу. Але у 2022 році Росія знов напала на Україну. І ця велика держава Росія виявилася переоціненою. Незважаючи на те, що її початкові спроби підпорядкувати всю Україну зазнали невдачі, українці знову побачили повторення історії. Тепер кожен бачить на власні очі, що історія повторяється. Той самий ворог, ті самі загарбники, ті ж самі бомбардування мирного населення, тортури, муки, розпач, страждання українського народу. Багато з нас у цій кімнаті замолоді, щоб пам'ятати страждання, яке завдала Друга світова війна біженцям. 50 дітей УПА, 75 дітей рейду, великого рейду УПА. І планується на осінь під свято Покрови 15-16 жовтня два концерти пропам'ятні, які будуть називатися «Від УПА до ЗСУ». І ці концерти будуть у Випені, Нью-Джерсі, і в Філадельфії, і в Чикаго. Так що згори запрошуємо і даємо знати про них. Добре, дякую.
Філ Карпер, for your information, in, is it April of 2014 that you mentioned?
March.
In last week of March, in 2014, Phil Carver, together with General Wesley Clark, former commander of NATO, traveled to Ukraine. They visited all the frontline units. They advised the Ukrainian government in organizing a defense in depth. Since then, Phil has been to Ukraine, visiting the frontline units 39 times. Yeah, I think that's a record, probably, from anybody in the United States. I know I only visited twice. I know my friend Boris Potapenko from our organization. He was there several times, but he probably visited 20 times, and I know Will visited, he visited from three times, okay, the head of the Ukrainian American Freedom Foundation. So Phil outdid us. Also, Phil has been at a lot of our Ukrainian-American gatherings. Because of his close contact with our fighters in Ukraine, we all joke amongst ourselves that Phil has gone native, he's become Ukrainian. Okay. So, are we ready? Okay, so we have the war report, as I said, in the beginning of, or at the end of last year, in December. Together with the Ukrainian Congress Committee of America, we sponsored a briefing, an online briefing. We had over 200 participants on that online briefing. This was for our Ukrainian-American community activists. It was called Warning of War, and the two main speakers were General Wesley Clark and Phil Carver. At that time, Wesley Clark said that the world is forewarned that the war is coming. Our gentlemen stated the war is coming, and they explained how it was going to happen, and the world is forewarned. Unfortunately, our experts also said that probably that warning won't be heeded, and the West, the United States, Europe, will be more or less unprepared for this, and we see that this happened. Thank God Ukraine was prepared, and they put up a wonderful brave fight. I know in Washington I was at meetings where people from the U.S. government were hoping that Ukraine would last.
Try to stand. Can you hear me okay? Just close enough. I'm not aware. The slides are hard enough to see.
You have to keep the mic up.
The slides are hard enough to see without me standing in the wind. So I'd also like to introduce my colleague, Ms. Serena Nahon. Many of you know her, but she's been at the farm with me for the last, since 2016. Probably about a half of my 189 days in front, and a very brave woman. And unfortunately, my tongue just doesn't do Ukrainian. And so without her translation and support, I would have been very ineffective. And so she is, anything that Carver does is a 50% result, is probably more. I actually have a saying that I developed over the last 2 years. You have a tough job to do? Give it to the Ukrainian woman. She may not do it. She may not do it, but she will get it done. All right, and first slide, please. So this is a bit of an anniversary. 8 years ago, General Park and I came back, and we'd reported to Congress in April of 14, and then they asked us to give a full report in July. And so that happens to be the cover of the report titled, Ukraine versus Russian state-sponsored terrorism. The reason I mention that is only in the last 60 days have people started saying, yeah, it is state-sponsored terrorism and atrocities. And it needs to be called that for what it is. By the way, there's a substantial legal implication by having the state designated as a state sponsor of terrorism. And that's something that the those who are friends of Ukraine ought to be pushing the Congress to do, because there's more than ample evidence before now, after 8 years, and particularly in the middle of the new aggression. Some other things that we raised in that report that ended up being kind of ahead of their time. One is this idea of Lend-Lease. Lend-Lease is not a scenario that was popular in 1940, when Britain was literally on its knees, and Churchill was desperate, so he traded Roosevelt of some British bases in exchange for 40 old destroyers. And that then led to a cornucopia of the next 4 years of military assistance by the United States to Britain. And other allied countries. We believe that is a significant option for Ukraine. We argued it in the summer of 2014. And 2 months ago, the United States approved, this Congress approved $40 billion for a Lend-Lease. That's the good news. So when Ukraine's friends call, go, hey, Doc, everybody calls me Doc. Hey, Doc, how do we get access to all this cool stuff? We keep asking for it, but not all of it's coming. I go, well, it's not a credit card or a debit card that you can go out and just order from Amazon or us and just start getting your tanks and your airplanes. They have to be politically approved. Each of our military services have to say, they can get this equipment without endangering our own security. All kinds of legal arrangements have to be made, not to mention logistics, maintenance, and training. So it's not an easy, and it's not like hitting a light switch, but it is there. And if voices supporting Ukraine make that argument daily, every politician you talk to, every person in the press that you mention, ask them, push them, because that is, in my view, probably the critical component to Ukraine's salvation. I'll come back and explain that a little bit later. Another term we introduced was rollover. Ukraine has a lot of Soviet era equipment. Quite frankly, they use it really quite well. Well, it had high losses. There's a lot of that equipment, or a number of it, still in Eastern Europe. So our idea was to, for example, with Poland, offer Poland American M1 tanks so they're interoperable with us, or German Leopard 2s, and they would then give T-72s to Ukraine. That happened just 5 weeks ago. We haven't even sent the tanks yet. We haven't even promised the Poles how many. But the Polish military, with their government, sent 240 Polish tanks to Ukraine. Sometimes during this, my voice breaks. I'm not embarrassed about it. I'm not showing off. I have a lot of friends lost in the last few weeks, and so some aspects are more dramatic than others. So a number of these issues will keep coming up, and I'll go through. Next slide, please. So we talked about, a lot of people talk about NATO expansion. And by the way, and including Russia, oh, it's terrible. You're moving this thing, this alliance towards us. And there's a kind of fundamental split between partisans, or those arguing for great power hegemony. So you say, oh, okay, so the United States has the right to draw a line here, and this is the United States, and this is Russia. That's how you got the bloodlands in Eastern Europe for literally centuries. Big powers fighting over. The other argument is that people have the right to self-determination. They have the right to decide who they want to hang around with, what kind of government they want. And when they are believers in a democratic system, then they want to hang around other democracies. So what you have isn't a military alliance headed towards Russia in the 90s. It was a group of nations that had been under Soviet control. And we were encouraging them to move in our direction, to reform their military, to reform their civil society, so that they would be part of the West. And generally, it worked incredibly well. We did not deploy forces in the East. In fact, most of the size of the armies of the guys who joined NATO were cut by by two-thirds, three-quarters of this. This was not an increase in threat to Russia. Russia increased the threat. Russia did a cyber attack on Estonia. Russia tried to keep the troops in countries that didn't want them, like Lithuania and Latvia. Russia attacked other countries. So this was not an issue of the West starting some kind of aggression against Russia. We need to just call it like it is, rather than fall for their line. The side to the other side is, one interesting thing that has come out in the last 4 months in this new aggression, or this new version of the war, escalated version of the war, is Putin has become very, very clear about what he wants. So in 2014, it was, we're just trying to support these poor Russian-speaking people who are being abused in Ukraine, and we're just trying to help them out. But we have no territorial ambitions. Maybe for Crimea. Well, maybe if they have a referendum and they beg to be part of this, sure. But he's been very clear now what he wants. He says, in a very significant state speech, he goes, I'm not bringing back the Soviet Union. So he's famously credited with having the phrase, the biggest political tragedy of the 20th century was the collapse of the Soviet Union. And a lot of Western commentators sort of stop there, but the actual quote is the tragedy because of 50 million Russians being left behind in the area that had been the Russian Empire prior to Bolshevism. So in this recent speech, he says, I'm not bringing back Soviet Union.
In fact, Stalin, the guys made a bunch of mistakes. I'm bringing back the Russian Empire. And as an empire, there are various peoples who live in that empire. And we want them to be happy, we want them to participate, but they do not have the right to be nations. They do not have the right to have self-determination. They're going to be in our collectivity that we decide and run the way we want it to run. Well, who are some of those people who do not have a right to exist as a nation? Finland, yeah. Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, Romania, Ukraine, Belarus, on and on and on. Secondly, if people resist having the blessings of being in our empire, then they're going to be treated harshly. And you hear the word Nazi thrown around a lot. And if you go through the Russian literature, which we have a whole series of specialists looking at it at Stomach Foundation, the verses are very clear. A Nazi is not someone who believes in the liturgy of National Socialism. They're not somebody who's anti-Semitic. They're not somebody who's a brown shirt or a rightist. A Nazi is somebody who does not want to, who resists being part of the Russian Empire as defined by Russians. That's the definition of a Nazi. And of course, once you define somebody as off the pale, then you can do anything you want to, including as discussed openly in the Russian parliament, having population today, I'm not talking about 1940 or the 30s, moving thousands of people to Siberia to re-educate them. And when guys are taken who resisted strongly, like in Mariupol, they're taken to camps. And the Russians then decide whether they, and all the rules are off. They torture them, they kill them, summarily, whatever they want to do. So that is that imperial domain. That's really what this battle is about. Next slide. Another issue, Putin said, Ukraine has a pretty strong military. In fact, Ukraine has stronger military than the last 10 countries to join NATO. Combined. Well, oh, my heavens. It's funny. We didn't appreciate that. The last 8 years, Clark and I have been running around saying, hey, that's a great potential. Those, for every Ukrainian who's out there on the front line, that's one American kid who doesn't have to be out there defending Eastern Europe. The Russians appreciate it. And so they say they have to be eliminated. They have to be occupied. That military has to be wiped out. Next slide. It's hard to see in this light, but if you sort of look at the dots. The dots there are Russian brigades and regiments in 2013, prior to the invasion of Ukraine, and the forces that were added since then. The largest peacetime military buildup since the end of the Second World War, aimed at Ukraine and NATO, and exercised in the 2017 Zapad exercise, which involved the invasion of Ukraine and NATO together, as well as the 2021 Zapad being West Russia exercise, which was the preparation exercise in September of 2021 for the this next phase of the war that we're currently seeing. Next slide. The Russians had a war plan. This plan is from 2014. We happen to get a copy of it. And we have about 160 pages of what was a top secret draft war plan. But it gives you kind of an idea of how they were planning on overrunning it. As you'll see when we look at the slides, what was different about this current one. But kind of, this is not something new that they've been thinking about. Next slide. So when Clark and I put together the the warning of war report, we said there's a number of things that are kind of, we need to figure out. We need to address, you know, why? What's Putin after? Now, after, due to his speeches and very clear declarations in the Russian parliament, we have a real definitive answer. But at the time, we were struggling with it. Why now? Part of the now was he and China have a strategic alliance. That didn't help him very much. So he wanted to have kick things off because China is also doing some stuff in Asia. And so the idea was he would get first dibs at extending his plan, and then he would support China. But Xi said, "Well, I'm not going to support this if you start this thing during the Beijing Olympics." So it actually, and because the winter was short this year, so instead of being a long winter in the east, so what happens on in the ground? You know, tanks, armored vehicles drive across. They're designed to go across, you know, dirt and rough stuff. But in the winter, when it freezes, most of them can still go pretty well across frozen ground. But when the frost melts and it turns into what the Russians just call general mud, even tanks get stuck. Everything just and for about a month or 6 weeks. Well, sure enough, because of the Olympics, they delay the beginning of the offensive, and the Russians had an enormous problem driving through the general mud, actually played for the Ukrainians this time. There's, as you look sort of the bottom questions, how long can Ukraine hold on? So Ukraine is a country, one-fourth the population of Russia, substantially smaller GDP, vulnerable. And that's really a critical question we're going to be addressing. Next slide. It's a little hard to see. If you look carefully, you'll see bits of yellow. Those are Russian units, Russian brigades, and then there's pink lines going all the way from the Far East, the Sakhalin, from the Baltic, all over Russia, flooding into Ukraine. What is that? So to understand the Russian strengths and weaknesses, which is going to take a bit of a segue. So back in the Soviet Union, the Russian size of the Russian military was over five million people. Well, they couldn't afford it. That's why they went broke. So the current Russian military, post-Soviet military, is about a million. That includes Navy, rocket forces, or ground forces, a couple hundred thousand. They wanted to have an all-volunteer military. But unless you're from a very poor area, or have no future, or maybe it's an option to go into jail by some judge, most guys don't want to serve in the Russian military as enlisted people. They're called contractors if you're a volunteer. So of the military and the ground forces, about 40% are contractors, but most of those contractors tend to be from the poorer areas and further in the south, maybe the center country. So they have to have draftees. Well, draftees don't want to be there. And so when they get sent into combat, and this is what happened in the first Chechen War, these draftees get sent in. They're not well-trained. They're not motivated. They take disproportionate casualties, and their mothers don't like it, and they create all kinds of hell in political circles because these kids are not from the boonies. These kids are drafted from Russian cities. So Putin, one of his major innovations in the Second Chechen War was to leave the conscripts at home. So you have a unit, 40% of the guys are conscripts, 40% are contractors, and 20% are your professional officer. And you go, I want to send this unit, but I don't want these kids to play, so what do I do? I take and create what's called a battalion tactical group. So I have a brigade, which is a higher organization, usually has four maneuver battalions. So I take pieces of those battalions and put them, glue them together, heavy in artillery, heavy in armor, but very light in infantry, because I don't have enough. So what happens when you get those guys committed into a combat like happened in the Battle at Kiev? They drive in, they broke through the Ukrainian positions very rapidly, and then they get strung out. They get caught into urban fighting. Well, urban fighting is like a snake. It just sucks in manpower. They didn't have enough. Not only that, they didn't have enough guys to guard their supply lines or to run the logistics trucks. They're up against Ukrainian infantry. Ukrainians, the one thing, they were motivated. And the more horrific things the Russians did, the more motivated the Ukrainians were. It was an enormous asymmetry. So that's sort of the origin, and they brought all these hodgepodge guys. So instead of having, they brought the equivalent of units from 12 armies, right? Five of them from the Far East, two from Central Russia, Siberia, two from the South, one from the North, and then the four around Ukraine already. But only pieces. So they had some exercises in the field, but they were mobilized rapidly between October and the beginning of the war in 4 months. And so they also were not, their command and control and their supplies were not well organized. Next slide. So this is a month into the war. And you can see where the Russians made initial penetrations, particularly in Kiev. What you can't see, it's very hard, is the Russians are by the end of that first month, are already starting to slow down. And then the second month of the war, they actually moved six armies that were aimed at Kiev, or the elements of six armies that got stalled. The Ukrainians didn't have the force to push them out. They stopped them, killed them in disproportionate numbers. But they didn't have enough. They've taken such heavy losses, particularly in their own armor, they didn't have the power to throw them out. The Russians decided to pull out. So they pull out the elements of these six armies from the north, and now they bring them around south of Kharkiv to launch the second phase of the war. That's all. And by the way, down in the south, they broke through very early and were able to cross the Dnieper River, seize the bridges. Mariupol, which is the point that the lower battle area, just the Sea of Azov, but had held out for 8 years. 8 years of attack from the east. But they got surrounded and put in an enormously valiant fight. It lasted for almost 3 months, but it was the Ukrainians, Alamo, the Russians, say they're going to summarily deal with the defenders. Next slide. So you see the part that's yellow there, where Kiev is, that means it's evacuated. They pulled them out. They would retreat. They came and essentially abandoned that area. And now they have been pushing in the south. Next slide. Again, just kind of focus on the red. So the Russians have this just enormous amount of force there. I talked to my former bodyguard back in 2014. He's now a lieutenant colonel, battalion commander at Kramatorsk, big kid. And he said, "Now, Doc, we're killing them. Four or five to one of us. We're just running out. Just running out. You have, you know, well-trained guys, active, and they take losses, so then you fill them in with reserves. Well, some reserves haven't been in as recently, a little rusty, maybe not as good physical shape, maybe a little bit older, not as old as me. Then you have, but they still know weapons, they still know combined arms, they still know military discipline procedure. Then you have volunteers. Well, these guys have never held a rifle before. They have no radios. They wouldn't know how to call in an artillery strike, and their life does depend on it. So you can't have those as separate units. So you take them in pockets and stick them in. Hopefully the guys with more experience will be able to kind of protect them and teach them. But the longer it goes, the more of your experienced guys you're losing. Yes, the other guys are learning, but it's they also tend to take heavier losses, and the attrition adds up. Next slide. So you can barely see it, unfortunately, but there in the mark 1,000 mark in 2014, that's the maximum casualties during the first 8 years of the war. So those little dots down there, and this is the casualties since. So to do a comparison, in all 8 years before, there was a total of 14,000 deaths. In 4 months, you had 40,000. You had 130,000 seriously wounded, and we don't really know what that number is because of the urban areas that have been flattened and seized by the Russians. So those towns, when the Russians run into these towns, it's interesting. In Kharkiv, Kiev, Chernihiv, Mariupol, where you have a major city with a lot of heavy monumental construction, the more you hit it with artillery, the better it is for the defenders, because it gives them more places to hide, more places to do ambushes, and it's less opportunity to maneuver. But in your average Ukrainian country hamlet, little small town, most two-story buildings, a lot of wood construction. What the Russians have been doing, started with Volnovakha. I know it well because I was there many times during earlier battles. They started one in the town, and in 48 hours with artillery, there wasn't a habitable building left. The place was just blown away. And it's 50, at least 50 Ukrainian towns. Now, in the Donbass alone, behind where the line has been moving, we don't know how many casualties there are. How many people are caught in the rubble? How many families were lost in the basement? The first 8 years of the war, Ukraine lost 7% of their territory. It's now up to 20%. First 8 years, Ukraine had lost the equivalent of 2 years' worth of GDP. Economists now, just in the last 4 months, from the infrastructure losses and the destruction of towns and cities, 20 years of GDP growth. Next slide. So, again, a little bit difficult to see, but the bluish white boxes are your regular Ukrainian units. And the green boxes are units that are the new territorials. Ukraine had been wanting to have a territorial defense. It talked about it, argued about it for a year and a half. I often say that you get two Ukrainians and you get at least three opinions, and sometimes it's hard to get decisions in the Ukrainian community. So the law for the territorials wasn't passed until the 1st of January, which was a strategic mistake. So they wanted to have 28 brigades, but they barely had one that was 50% manned when the war started. So they're grabbing guys literally off the street and handing them AKs and saying, here you are. Now that, because of the, as I mentioned, the losses, they're having to put them in the front. All the blue units that are not in the front line, the blue and white ones, like the first armored up, the highest unit next to the green, that's the first armored Chernihiv. They lost about 90% of their tanks and armored vehicles in the defense of Kiev. one of the most heroic army of retrogrades. Fight, fall back, fight, fall back, counterattack, fall back. Taking on 8-9 times their strength. Part of the reason that Russian offensive failed. When you lose a T-72 tank, about 67% of the time, the turret blows off and you lose most of your crew. So you not only lose the tanks, you lose the crews. So then even if you get replacement, you have to train guys to do it. So the only units, the blue ones that are sitting there in the back are either training or units that were so beat up. So beat up, they had to be reconstituted. By my count from 2 weeks ago, just came back, by the way, headed back to Europe tomorrow. Ukraine had lost 50% of its tanks, two-thirds of its infantry fighting vehicles. When those infantry vehicles blow up, it's catastrophic. The troops don't even ride inside anymore, they ride on top. Start getting shot at, you jump off and disperse. They call them iron coffins, because they're just not well protected, against, particularly the modern munitions. They've lost about, Ukraine has lost about 40% of its artillery. And they've used up a vast majority of the artillery stocks they have. The replacements that we have sent are not a fraction of the losses, but they're enormously helpful and they're very appreciative. It's just not enough. So there's some big gaps. Why am I showing that map without the territorials? It is essentially, there is no operational or strategic reserve. If Russia breaks through, they've been grinding it. I mean, literally a block at a time, and just eating up these little towns, taking huge losses, and then just put another guy, another unit in. If they break out into the steppe, if they get to Slovyansk and Kramatorsk, which is sort of the keys to the defense of the East, if they get there, it then moves out into the steppe. It goes from an infantry battle, which was in Kiev, to an artillery dominant battle, which was in the east, and then it's going to be an armor battle in the on the steppe. It's tank country. And Ukraine doesn't have enough. Next slide. Some things to think about. We heard a lot going into the war about, we have to deter. So we're going to deter the Russians with the threat of sanctions. It didn't work. Then we said, well, we're going to deter Russia by threatening to arm Ukraine if Russia attacks. That sounds kind of like a cool deal because you're kind of holding the stick in abeyance, but if you cross that line, I'm going to whack you. The problem is when he crosses the line, it's too damn late to get the stuff there. We say, we're going to send Stinger air defense missiles. The first Stingers didn't arrive until 3 days after the war had already started. The guys in Mariupol, Ukraine's at Alamo, were under daily bombing attack by Russians. And they didn't have a single Stinger, because they had been able to get them into them before they were surrounded. Escalation. One of the great frauds in our intellectual thinking, just think about this. This was a semi-frozen, bleeding conflict, right, up till February 24th. Russia brings in the largest amount of force, 12 armies. That level of force had never been in Europe since 1945. Since the Cold War, since 1945. And you go, concentrate. And you go, who's escalating? Oh, they launch 2,000 cruise missiles up to 1,000 kilometer range. But it would be escalatory. It would be so escalatory if we gave Ukraine a missile that goes 100 kilometers. What kind of bizarre logic are we following? Sanctions. It's an interesting deal. It happened by almost by accident. Was reading a study of a criminology study, and the author made the point: criminals are not deterred by sanctions; they just move to a different target. Mm-hmm. If they have, you know, it's often Russia is often described as a criminal enterprise. Right? We're going to go after. Sorry. Two last words we need to be very careful about. So Ukraine right now could really use a break. They really need a month, maybe 6 weeks, just to rest, to regroup, train, just dig in. It would be an enormous help. The problem is that where the previous line of contact was 600 kilometers, the current line of contact is 2,400, four times the line of engagement. You say, well, so what? Well, that means your defenses are stretched to one-fourth the density along that line. And then you say, oh, but I've already had big losses and casualties. Oh, I'm down to one-eighth the defensibility. So then whoever has the most force, and particularly armor and artillery shock power, or dominance of the air, if they knew how to use it, could, if they launch the strike, and they then drive the events. So a ceasefire that goes longer than a month is going to be to Ukraine, not only to Ukraine's detriment, because Russia will benefit more by being able to bring in more of their replacements. They got 40 units that are currently being that got the crap beat out of them, but they are reconstituting them and fleshing up manpower and stuff. So if the ceasefire goes longer than 4 or 6 weeks, Russia then is going to have the advantage. So somehow this war's got to end. So there's, so other than this, the ceasefire argument, people say, well, you know, let's sit down and talk to the Russians. And we need to get this war done. So you say, wait a second, Putin, we said, has now been very clear what his objectives are. Okay? But let's assume he signs on to something. And you say, wait a second. The Russians signed the Helsinki Act, and they violated it. They signed the CFE Treaty post-Cold War. They violated it. They signed the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, that countries that don't have nuclear weapons will not be attacked by a nuclear power. They violated it. They violated the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty and the Nuclear Weapons in Europe Treaty, formal treaties. They violated the Budapest Agreement. They violated the first Minsk I ceasefire agreement, and they violated the second. So who the hell is going to trust these guys for whatever they put on a piece of paper? It's delusional. So you say, okay, what's the answer? And the only answer is to defeat that Russian army in the field. And if we don't, whatever happens, as Americans, whatever happens to Ukraine, you know, we're going to be picking up the mess. So one of the most common things I get is people say, oh, well, you know, it's a long way away. We're not going to. We wouldn't fight for Eastern Europe. So, well, wait a minute. We have to have a treaty commitment for a whole bunch of the guys that Putin is now having on the hit list. Okay. But if you just look at the last 100 years, World War I starts in Eastern Europe. We're not going to be involved. Within 3 years, we were sacrificing 170,000 dead. World War II, Oh, we don't want to, you know, Britain's a good friend of ours, we give a little bit at least, but we don't want to get involved. The Japanese helped them out. But in the end, 450,000 dead over the European war that started in Eastern Europe. We led the effort for NATO expansion to try to bring peace and stability into Eastern Europe, not threaten Russia. That was our deal. And you don't think we're going to end up fighting? So we have every reason to take this seriously. And what do we need? We need to help the Ukrainians get armed. If we will give them a modest number of planes and some of our better ground equipment, some decent air defense, they will. They have the capacity. If they can hold them like they have, and if they can kill four Russians for every Ukrainian, and give them some decent weaponry, and they will defeat that Russian army in the field. And that is real deterrent. So thank you very much. I'm happy to have some any questions or criticism. Just the army.
We have 15 minutes for questions. I got a question.
Okay, so somebody here, yeah. So, yeah, first I'll just point my way.
Yes, sir. General Petraeus says that the West is giving me weaponry to fight, but not weaponry to win. What would it take, what kind of weaponry would it take to win?
General Clark and I have a report. I'm actually briefing NATO next week. So here's the numbers. Approximately 100 F-16s, 30 to 50 A-10 attack aircraft or H-64 attack helicopter. By the way, all of which we have in substantial numbers, and in fact, because we're getting new aircraft or new versions of those aircraft, we have plenty on our side. We have more weapons than we have manpower or force structure to use. The American taxpayers already paid for it. This is not new stuff. And it doesn't have to be the latest model. So 100 fighters and 50 some type of attack, ground attack aircraft. The Marines are lightening up because they're getting ready to go fight in Asia, and they figured, I'm a former Marine, I'm not sure the logic is, but they figure they don't need tanks. So the Marines have 180 tanks, well maintained. They're pulling out of the Marine Corps. While we send them to Ukraine. Or, if that's a stretch, let's send 180 tanks to Poland, because I had spent 8 hours with the Polish Chief of Defense on this last trip, and he promised me, you guys, the Poles have ordered, and they pay serious money for this stuff. They go, we've already ordered and paid for M1s, we just can't get them. So if we give those Marine M1s to the Poles, he will give the Ukrainians another 250 Polish tanks. But he said, I can't. I already gave 240. I can't completely denude my force. Infantry fighting vehicles. We have. Oh, by the way, go on Google Earth and check it out. Sierra Army Depot. Look down on it. 2,000 M1 tanks lined up. 500 tubes of artillery. Another base here in the east. 2,000 Bradley infantry fighting vehicles, which is twice as effective as the stuff the Ukrainians have. In good shape. We already paid for them. Same with artillery. And we also need to cut this delusional stuff out about as General Sobrowski raised about the range of systems. You know, we have systems that the Ukrainians. Why is range important? Is it important to hit Russia? No. The important part is because you'd be hitting into space behind the lines anyway, generally, maybe an ammo depot. But the reason is if you have 150 kilometer range on your artillery instead of 50, one unit can cover literally an exponentially larger area with support on the flanks, right? That's why they need the range.
Next question.
Yes, sir.
Okay, keep honest. What's your take on the attack from Belarus with the primary target maybe being the Rivne nuclear power plant?
you know, they can, I you know, it's hitting the nuclear power plants. I don't mean to prove it.
Take over in order to cut it off from the energy grid.
Yeah, you can. I mean, and they played with it. It's kind of cheap thrills. I mean, okay, so you shoot up a power plant or you spill. What have you gained by it? It has an effect on the grid. You're right, but it by itself, I don't see that as the objective. Serious objective from Belarus is to drop down and take Lviv and cut Ukraine off from the West. When I was when we were there, we arrived in Lviv and we were under a missile attack. We left Kiev. We were under air attack. The Russians are systematically trying to knock out rail bridges and the electrical generation for the rail lines. So roughly half of the Ukrainian railroads are electrified, but the main intercity routes are 90% electrical, and the locomotives are 90%. So if you try to take that out, Ukraine's ability to move stuff rapidly is going to be a significant. So the danger I would consider would be dropping down and trying to cut them off. So that's the bad news. The good news is the Russians have some forces in Belarus, but not nearly enough to do it. They'd have to depend on the Belarusians. The Belarusians have put five different brigades right on the border just in the last couple of weeks. So they're fine. By the way, it was a mass letter written by Belarusian officers saying, it's the second time now, to Lukashenko saying, we are not Russian mercenaries and we are not Russian meat. And so we have no interest in attacking Ukraine. But that I think would be a more realistic purpose. Yes, ma'am. And then
yes. Is there an inherent systemic reluctance of the United States to maintain a friend-foe relationship with Russia? It has over the years, and due to our alliances in the past. Is there a sort of relationship, it's an undertow,
sure,
not to destroy Russia, not to help Ukraine?
Sure. And the short answer is, yes. So if you hear the word existential threat, okay, the people say, oh, a terrorist attack could be an existential threat. No. I'll tell you what an existential threat is. 2,000 Russian nuclear weapons aimed at the United States. That is 300 nuclear weapons basically takes the United States into the Dark Ages. You take out every city over 50,000 people, and you denude the United States of all its electricity, all its oil. Okay? So literally, you don't go to that Stone Age, you just go back to the Dark Ages. That's 300. Put another 1,700 on there, and you are literally living in caves, okay? I kid you not. And so, yes, you have to take people who have that capability serious. And, but that doesn't mean you give in to them. They don't want to die either. Well, Putin did make this really strange, that the head of the Russian Orthodox Church had told him that the Russian would survive the Russian people would survive a nuclear weapon, a nuclear war. He may have better context there, or delusional. But no. So you take them seriously. By the way, watch out. You know, people say, oh, China only has 90 nuclear weapons in the United States. Well, they're headed to 300, and probably within by the end of this decade, they'll have 1,000 themselves. So see, when people have this stuff, you got to take more seriously. That doesn't mean you give in to them. That does not mean you go there and there's a funny story. So quickly, and then the last question. I promise you.
I was first.
I know, but I was working on my book. What? Okay, I'll come back to my story. Yes, sir. Give.
Careful comment on the offer that Duda made to Ukraine 29 MiGs. For F-16s,
yep.
And the pilots are already trained on the base, so there's no need to train ground crews or pilots, and those 29 MiGs would be a tremendous amount of help for the infantry.
Right. So, yeah, absolutely right. I had a long talk with both the Polish president's office and the chief of the Polish army. And he's willing to do it tomorrow. And he said, I'm not making it quid pro quo. So Poland has, their air force consists of basically two large air units, that are large, 40 to 50 planes. One of them is F-16s, and one is old MiG-29s. And the Poles have been ordering F-16s. But they can't give their 40% of their air force away without some assurance they're gonna get replacements. They said, I'll even do it, and you can tell me they're coming. It's, you know, I don't have to have them in hand. By the way, well, you also on the subject. You know, so Ukraine has foreign fighters, but in my view, what's needed is, and I put it on the, oh, it was the last bullet on there. What they need is foreign experts. So, for example, there are thousands of former F-16 drivers all over Europe, like 10 is the most popular plane in NATO. So it's not just the pilots, it's the ground crews. There's no reason to say with people, oh, well, M1's really complex. Actually, it's pretty easy to operate, but it's a gas hog, and it's a maintenance challenge. Okay, so bring over some American warrant officers, and they're not going to necessarily volunteer. Pay them. No, it's like Claire Chennault's Flying Tigers. That is a canard. The idea that, first of all, the Ukraine can't learn. We sent them the first counter-battery radar. We didn't even include the cables, and we didn't give them the software. It was like Obama's FU. I was like, oh, Poroshenko was begging for it, so he sent it. And they'll never have this figured out in 6 months. 6 weeks later, they were operating it. They'd written their own software. They'd done their own connectivity. And you know what we found out? They had doubled the range, and they were using it in a way we had never, which was to acquire unmanned aerial vehicles. So Ukrainians can help, but you say, obviously you can't learn all that in a couple weeks. But you get those drivers, those maintenance mechanics, and not every maintenance guy has to be a foreigner. You get the chief guy, so he tells people, and then train the trainer. So there's a great potential there. Yeah. So, but we have to decide. We have to decide. We want to. And by the way, we ought to be doing it for Poland, irrespective of what we think about Ukraine, because the Poland, once Ukraine goes down, Poland is the next one. Yes, sir.
I just finished. The rumors are that Mr. Biden said he cannot aggravate the situation by giving the Ukraine these MiGs, because Putin's not going to like that, and he's going to get more offensive. Now, I don't know if this is hearsay, but people that I've spoken to claim that this is a fact.
There are a number of advice. So Biden, in my opinion, has ended up, he's cautious, but he has, I think, a little bit more guts than people give him credit. I'm not making a political speech here. I think a lot of the younger staffers in the National Security Council are not military professionals. They come from congressional staff, and they all Harvard trained, you know. Probably some of them are my students, some are some of them. And they go, oh, I read Tom Schelling's book on escalation. We got to be really careful, you know. So that's why I say this idiocy on escalation. We got to stop confusing ourselves with our own rhetoric. So a related issue is stop talking about it.
Just do it.
So you take three plates and you fly them to Slovakia. Or the Ukrainian pilots go there and fly them in Slovakia, and then one night one of them shows up here, and one night over here, and they're repainting them, I mean, not. And then three more. The Russians will figure it out. But instead of saying weeks in advance and then having everybody in NATO opine on what's going on and debating in the front page of the New York Times, or the editorial section, more likely, just do it. And this is not. Brain, it's not brain size, it just requires a strategy. Yes, sir, the last comment.
Can you comment on General Austin's comment, our aim is for Ukraine is to weaken Russia? That's, I think that says a lot.
So, I don't like the comment personally, and I'll tell you why.
You don't like what I said?
It's kind of chicken shit comment, excuse my French, but it's kind of a chicken comment.
Yeah.
Now, in a way, it's a rephrasing of what I said earlier. It is in our strategic interest to see Ukraine not go down. If Ukraine can't survive a ceasefire and can't survive Russian forces for another 8 years going on, and so the only answer to that is to defeat Russian forces, it is in our strategic interest to have that happen. But that's not the same as saying, oh, yeah, you guys do our fighting for us. So two quick stories. So it's the summit last spring. Biden's meeting with Putin. He goes, Vladimir, very serious. My number one election domestic priority is global warming. And I believe, you know, we have to all band together, and I want your help. I want to make it our joint international act. I said, please help me. So Putin, thoughtful, thanks advice. No problem, Mr. President. I bring back the Cold War. And the last one to leave with. If NATO and the West roots out the corruption of our leaders who play games with either the footsies with Russians getting paid under the table or sending their sons to make money or what, pick your party, pick your country. But the West weeds out its corruption. And if we decide that we have to have a serious military and we do the buildup that we ought to be doing, and we, I'm trying to say this right, we restore our manly apertures, we might, the West, NATO, just might be allowed to join Ukraine.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Phil, for your briefing. I hope this is very informative for our audience. We were taping this briefing and we're going to put it all together and we'll circulate it amongst our community. To be able to do our work in Washington, we all need to be very well informed. These types of briefings with the slides gives us the ammunition where we can argue the fact that Ukraine needs more support, more weapons. Thank you, Phil, for taking time out.
Душу тіло ми положим за нашу свободу і покажем, що ми браття за свого роду.